Hey, you guys are looking all stripy. Hey, last Sunday I had you guys smell some things, but I brought new things today. But last Sunday there was one or two that were kind of stinky, right? Yeah, and you were mad at me, and I don't want you to be mad at me. So, three things, none of them are offensive, and I'm not lying to you, okay? Well, one of them might be offensive. Well, two might be offensive. But that would be kind of on you, because they're really not offensive smells. So, I'm going to have you smell each one. You can tell me which one is more warm doing first. Which one do we want to smell first? This one, or this one? This one? Okay, we're going to smell this one first. Now, don't say whether or not you like it. Don't even tell me what you think it is. Tell me it all the way down. All right, ready? Now in your mind, here's what I need you to do. It's just a cotton ball, right? But what's it smell like? So in your mind, see if you can know what it smells like. Don't tell me what it is. Do you know what it smells like? No. Another smell? Furrowed brow. You're going to have lines like me. Oh, you got to be careful about that. What's it smell like? What's that smell like? Okay, here, we'll put this one over here. Now, number two. Okay. You can smell that one all the way down there, can't you? Yeah. Well, it's not a bad one. It is strong. It's not bad here, down here. Can you smell it? Okay, now, don't tell me what it is, but you think you know what it is? Okay. Which one was stronger, the first one or the second one? Second one, definitely stronger, right? Okay? What do you think? Okay, alright. Let's go back to the first one. Ready? First one. You remember the first one? Real quick. Do you know what it smells like? That one does? That one smells like? You smell anything? Okay. Second one? I don't even need to get it close to you. Okay, what is this one? It's not gas, but it's close. Petroleum product. This is called liquid wrench. You know what this smells like? I mean, it is liquid wrench, so it smells like liquid wrench. But smell is like this to me. When I smell this one, liquid wrench, that makes me think about my workbench and my garage and the kind of work you do where you're working on something but you don't feel like you're working on it because you're enjoying working on it, right? That's what this smells like. This is good work to me, right? That one's work. This one, remember this one? Yeah, do you know what this is? Anybody know what this one? What? It's not water detergent, it's not soap, you're close. This is the lotion that my wife wears. This smells like my beloved Linda. Tell me, who's the prettiest girl in the world? Which one? She's the prettiest, isn't she? You would think the bride would be the prettiest, but this is the one I married. This is a couple of months before my wedding. This is the girl that introduced my wife to me, but that's the prettiest one. Isn't she pretty? That's like months before we got married, and we just like 37 years married. Sorry, that's what I'm thinking about her. This last one, which was the first one, does it smell like anything? No, it doesn't. I mean, it smells like a cotton ball. I didn't put anything on it, so it's a cotton ball. Doesn't smell like anything, it just smells like nothing. Do you know that God lives in heaven, and there's a room in heaven that's his throne room, and it has his throne chair, and then there are 24 smaller thrones around his throne, right? And there are some people or beings that sit in these throne chairs, so we know what heaven looks like. We know what these people or beings are doing, how they worship God, what they sound like. We know what heaven looks like. We know what heaven sounds like. Do we know what heaven smells like? I do. Let me tell you. Do you know what heaven smells like? I do. Tell you what. I'll tell you in about 30 minutes. And if you don't hear it from me during my sermon, then you ask your grandma, you ask your parents, what's heaven smell like? Because I discovered a verse this week that tells me what heaven smells like. And it surprised me. I wanted it to smell kind of like bacon, you know? But it doesn't smell like bacon. It smells like something different. A chocolate fountain, that'd be good too. I'm going to give you a hint right now, but I'm not going to tell you I'm going to give you a hint. I guess I already did. But, all right? So I'm going to pray with you right now. And you're just going to either have to listen or ask grandma or your parents, say, what does heaven smell like? That's not true, but that's a good guess. All right, come over here. We're going to pray together. Jesus, I thank you that you give us the ability to smell. And I thank you that things can smell really good to us and things can smell really offensive to us. Once we discover what heaven smells like, will you help us to appreciate what heaven smells like and do what we can to make it smell even better? And that's part of our job. Thank you for these kids. We pray in your name. Amen. See you guys. Smell, aroma is really huge in memory triggers. There's a lot of research on that. But we already knew that, right? Like, for instance, when I was in junior high, and Kurt's family would be driving around. There were four of us. I was the youngest. And we're driving around in the 73 Ford Torino wagon with the windows up. What is my mother doing? Her nails. Constantly. And it drove us crazy. The stench of fingernail polish inside a closed car to a junior high boy. To this day, I grow bitter when I smell fingernail polish at my mother. I grew up in the lower middle class, and there were four Kurtz kids, and so mom and dad were trying to stretch the grocery budget, and they had this thing we had every week. Biscuits, and if you remember that chip beef that you'd buy in the bag, it's really thin stuff, my dad would tear it up. My mom would make the biscuits, my dad would tear it up, and he would pretend to make gravy. That meant cream of mushroom soup, right? And he would just, and the smell of that, and I swear we had that meal every week. The first 100 times it tasted good. But by the time I was in eighth grade, it stopped tasting good. We had that meal all the time. It was cheap, and it filled our bellies to this day. Mm-mm. Oh, stop being negative. Lilacs. I cut our first lilacs this week. And I only cut three little sprigs of them and put them in a vase. And these three little sprigs are just filling our dining room with this smell. And that's an important smell. Because for our anniversary, like 8 years in, we planted a lilac bush. We always have a lilac bush wherever we live. And I can't wait until they blossom because they're so aromatic. I love lilacs. Chicago. Some of you go, oh, I've been to Chicago, it stinks. It doesn't stink, it smells wonderful. It has a very distinct city smell. It's different from New York or Boston or any place else. It's a Chicago smell, and I love it. Maybe I love it because I'm not Lindish in Chicago. We had our anniversary a week ago. I'm really focused on her right now, more than normal. Do you remember the 1982 movie Annie? With Danny Warbucks, Carol Burnett played Miss Hannigan. Do you remember that? And you remember the little redhead that played the role of Annie, and she gets invited to Daddy Warbucks' home, and she's standing there. She's an orphan. She's standing in the grand hall of Daddy Warbucks' home. And what was the assistant to Warbucks? Grace Farrell, I think, was her character name. And Grace Farrell is standing next to little Annie, and Annie stands there, and she closes her eyes, and she breathes in through her nose, And then Ms. Pharaoh says, what are you doing? And she says, leaping lizards, I'm making a memory through her nose. Smell is really important. Do you know what it smells like in the throne room of God? I do. I'm going to teach you that this morning. We need to go to the book of Revelation where the apostle John got a glimpse of what the throne room of God looks like, and he writes a really weird book to end our New Testament, right? So symbolic, so much of it that we don't understand. I'll be the first to admit there are a lot of it I have no idea what's going on. But then there are the parts that I do know what's going on. And it makes me want to see the throne room of God, which I will one day do. And then I'm going to catch the parts that I don't understand, all right? Revelation chapter 4 tells us what it looks like in the throne room of God. And boy, am I going to read to you today. Start at verse 2, chapter 4, last book of the Bible. At once I was in the Spirit, John writes, and there before me was a throne in heaven with someone sitting on it. And the one who sat there had the appearance of jasper and carnelian, and a rainbow resembling an emerald encircled the throne. Surrounding the throne were 24 other thrones, and seated on them were 24 elders. They were dressed in white and had crowns of gold on their heads. From the throne came flashes of lightning, rumblings, and peals of thunder. Before the throne, seven lamps were blazing. These were the sevenfold spirits of God. And before the throne, there was what looked like a sea of glass, clear as crystal. In the center, around the throne, were four living creatures, and they were covered with eyes in front and in back. The first living creature was like a lion. The second, an ox. The third had a face like a man. The fourth was a flying eagle. Each of the four living creatures had six wings and was covered with eyes all around, even under his wings. Day and night, they never stopped saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Now, don't close your Bible. We're coming back to that paragraph in a minute. But you're getting the scene, right? I tried to set up the scene down here. So in the throne room of God, there is the throne of God sitting on it, right? God the Father is sitting on the throne room. And around the throne are 24 smaller thrones, and they're going to be the thrones of the elders. Who are the elders? Don't worry about it. Just picture 24 thrones in a semicircle going around. And then there are these four really weird-looking characters, beings, right? And you notice right at the end of the reading, in verse 8, each of the four living weird-looking creatures that have six wings and covered with eyes all around, day and night, verse 8, they never stop saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Let me say that again. Day and night, they never stop saying. What's it sound like in heaven? Day and night, they never stop. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, here's the sound of heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Constantly, this humming in heaven, holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Will you help me? Say it with me, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Again, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, there is this humming of holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. You saw that in verse 7. And then you look at verse 9, this is starting to get noisy. There's just this hum of noise, but then you keep going and you start reading in verse 9. Whenever the living creatures gave glory, holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty, who was and is in this town. Whenever they gave glory, honor, and thanks to him who sits on the throne and who lives forever and forever, the 24 elders fall down before who sits him who sits on the throne and worships him who lives forever and forever. They lay down their crowns before the throne and say, you are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being. All right, come on, let's get this, right?
So 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, we have these four creatures who are humming, "Holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." And that verse 9 says, and every time they do that, what do you mean every time they do that? They're doing it constantly. And every time they do that, then the 24 hours fall down in front of Jesus, fall down in front of the Father, and they hand him to their crowns. And they then say, "You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created everything." Oh my goodness, heaven is a really noisy place. And it's just constant, the humming of holy, holy, holy. And then the elders falling down and they're worshiping and they're presenting gifts to the Father. And did it smell yet? Not yet. So you got to read a little bit in chapter 5. "Then I saw in the right hand of him who sits on the throne a scroll with writing on both sides and sealed with seven seals. I saw a mighty angel proclaiming in a loud voice, 'Who is worthy to break the seals and open the scroll?' But no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth could open the scroll or even look inside it. I wept and wept because no one found was worthy to open the scroll and look inside. Then one of the elders said to me, 'Do not weep. See, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has triumphed. He is able to open the scroll and its seven seals.'" All right, so you get the seven. There's a scroll, right? And it has seven seals. I always pictured it like it had seven wax seals on the outside edge. I did a little research. It has, they write on it, and then they seal it. Then they write, roll it up, then write more and seal it. So it's like seven chapters of the book. So as you're unraveling the scroll, you come to a new seal, and you read a little bit more of the story. What is on that scroll? What does it say? It's writing on the front and the back. You read that. What's written on it? I have no idea. Frankly, I don't think the scholars have any idea because there are so many guesses all over the board and they all make sense. Like some of the scholars believe that it's the prophecies fulfilled from the Old Testament. God did this, opened a new seal, and God did that, and opened a new seal, and God did that, and it's the prophecies that have come true. What the hell would make sense? That's what's written on. Well, then, yeah, I'll tell you, read the next theory. It's the Old and the New Testament incomplete. Now, that would be a miracle, because the New Testament isn't even done being written yet. It won't be written for years. Okay, so that would be a miracle. That makes sense. Yeah. Okay, how about this one? It's the next few chapters of John's Revelation. That makes sense. Or maybe it's God's document of judgment against his enemies. Hey, here's how God's going to end this game. Or maybe it's the last will and testament of God, his final settlement of the affairs of the universe. That's what scholar Barclay says. In other words, I don't have any idea what's on that scroll. There are a lot of great theories out there. I'll leave that to the scholars. But guess what? My intent in studying this chapter was not to find out what's on the scroll. I'm paying attention to the smell of heaven. And I haven't smelled anything yet, have you? Not yet? Got to read a little bit more. Look at verse 6. "Then I saw a lamb looking as if it had been slain, standing in the center of the throne, encircled by the four living creatures and the elders. He had seven horns and seven eyes, which are the sevenfold spirits of God, sent out to the whole earth. He came and he took the scroll from the right hand of him who sat on the throne. And when he had taken it, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the lamb. Each one had a harp. And they were holding golden bowls of incense, which are the prayers of the saints, and they sang a new song. 'You are worthy to take the scroll to open its seals, because you were slain, and with your blood you purchased men for God from every tribe and nation and people, every tribe and language and name, people and nation. You have made them to be a kingdom and priests and to serve our God, and they will reign on earth for heaven.'" So the Lamb coming, he takes the scroll, and he alone is worthy to open it. And once it's taken, the 24 elders fall down and they worship God. And when they worship God, did you notice what was in their one hand and what was in their other hand? In their one hand, they have a harp. Don't picture the big harps we have now. This is a shepherd's harp. It's a little harp, right? And so they have this one-handed harp. What's in their other hand? Incense. Centuries of incense. And what's incense? Aroma. And what is the incense that they have? The prayers of the saints. Hey kiddos, are you listening to me? Do you know what heaven smells like? The prayers of the saints. When King David gets caught in his own mess, his adultery and his murder, and Nathan comes to him and says, hey, you really messed up. When David is caught, David cries out to God and he says, Lord, I have sinned against the Lord. That's our matter to God. Do you remember when Jesus was going around the earth and he's just meeting with people, most of them broken people, and he's healing them, and one guy comes to him and he says, Jesus, I brought my son who is demon-possessed to your disciples, and they couldn't do anything. Can you please deliver my son from this evil spirit? And Jesus says, if you'll believe I can do it, I can do it. And the guy says, I do believe. Help my unbelief. That's aromatic to God. When Thomas, who was doubting Thomas, hasn't seen the resurrected Lord, and then he's confronted with Jesus, and Jesus says, touch me, I'm real. He cries out, my Lord and my God. That's aromatic to God. When Isaiah says, Woe is me, for I am undone, I am a man of unclean lips. That admission is aromatic to God. When Paul says, God, fill them with your knowledge, he cries out to God. He says, fill them with your knowledge through all spiritual wisdom and understanding. That's aromatic to God, what creates the aroma of heaven. Prayer is But it's not just the prayers of the saints that are trapped in Scripture. When we pray for Judy, who's having trouble with her shoulder, that's aromatic to God. Weeks ago, when we prayed for Tom's cousin, who had found a mass, that's aromatic to God. When we prayed for Vivian, that's aromatic to God. When we pray for Paul Agnew, that's aromatic to God. When we thank God for another good day of coming to Presbyterian, we praise God for what he's done in just the renovation of our sanctuary. That's aromatic to God. That's the smell of heaven. That's my name. 2 months of the time. Because I admit I don't really get prayer. I don't understand. And I haven't understood it for a long time. So because I don't understand it, yeah, I haven't been smell like anything. Because I don't understand it. I've said this to you before. So am I supposed to take God and give him my prayer list and say, okay, if you can take care of this, I'll be back at noon to talk to you again to make sure you did all your things. I'm sure that I am not supposed to, and God needs to do this. So I go, gosh, I don't really know. I wrote him down. Or when I go to God and I say, God, I'm just, can you hear me or am I talking to myself? Do you ever feel like that when you pray? Yeah, so I just don't pray. It's really interesting to me. I would like to believe what you guys say to me week after week, because you're so kind. You're just really nice people. So you tell me on the way out, you know, last Sunday was good, but that was a good sermon. I think that might be your best one. Well, come on, can it get better every week? No, it can't. I know that, you know that. You're just being nice, right? You're lying to me. But it's funny to me. Though I know I will hit a home run every time I come up into the batter's box, I keep trying in my preaching. Though I stumble onto pages of scripture and I go, I have no idea what that scroll business is. I don't stop reading my Bible. When somebody's broken and hurting, I'll stop and I'll put a hand on them and I'll pray for them right there. I keep trying, even though I don't get a lot of parts of my spiritual life right. But when it comes to the aroma of heaven, it just doesn't smell like anything. Because I don't get prayer, so I go, When I discovered Revelation chapter 5, and it's still this discovery started happening a couple of weeks ago, I said, what's heaven smell like? What does the throne room of God smell like? Well, if it's based on my prayers, it's, there's this faint, almost, I think I smell something. We need to smell heaven up. And guess what? We might get it wrong. We might say, hey, God, take care of this. I'll be back at noon. And God goes, yeah, that's not quite how it works, but thanks for coming and talking to me. You're making heaven smell. Hey, God, I want it my way, so I'm going to pray, do this according to my will. Heal everybody. And God goes, it doesn't really work that way, but thank you for smelling up heaven. Let's smell up heaven this week. And if we get it wrong, it's like everything else. God will say, nice try, good try. 10 points forever. Now let me tell you how it really works. But let's make heaven smell like something. I got to show you the end of the chapter. That's really my message, but I got to show you the end of the chapter. Verse 11. Then I looked and I heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands and 10,000s upon 10,000s. They encircled the throne and the living creatures and the elders in a loud voice. The thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of angels in a loud voice saying, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. Stop right there. So if I don't know what to pray, I got an idea. I'm going to steal the angel's words. Hey, Lord, you're worthy to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. If I don't know what to pray, at least I can pray that and make some smell in heaven. But keep reading. Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and on the sea and all that is in them singing, to him who sits on the throne, to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever. If I don't know what to pray, I got an idea. Do you see who's praying in verse 13? Every creature in heaven, on earth, under the earth, even fish. They're all praying, saying, to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever. At least I can pray that. And the chapter ends with this. The four living creatures said, amen. And the elders fell down and worshipped. Amen. You know what that means, right? So be it. So be what? To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever. So be it. And the elders fall on their face and worship God. I can do that. Let's smell up heaven this week. Even if you're like me and you don't really get it, try. God can always give us a redo. It's better than it not smelling like anything. Man, what a perfect transition into our prayer time. Right? Whoops. That's what I needed anyway. On our insert in your board that has some prayer lists, we added some happy.